الذين آمنوا وتطمئن قلوبهم بذكر الله، ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب.
الذين آمنوا وتطمئن قلوبهم بذكر الله، ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب.
ألا بذكر الله تطمئن
الحمد لله، الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وقضى ربك ألا تعبدوا إلا إياه وبالوالدين إحسانا، إما يبلغن عندك الكبر أحدهما أو كلاهما فلا تقل لهما أف ولا تنهرهما وقل لهما قولا كريما، واخفض لهما جناح الذل من الرحمة، وقل رب ارحمهما كما ربياني صغيرا. صدق الله العظيم، وبلغنا رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. Respected ulama, ikram, brothers, elders, mothers and sisters in Islam, all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Peace and salutations be upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All praise and thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has guided us to this beautiful deen. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has guided us and granted us the wonderful gift of iman. And all praise and thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for each and every bounty and ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. Respected brothers and elders, to begin with, we see our topic, those who care for us most. Before we go into our topic, I'd like to greet each and every one of you with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with many, many ni'mats and bounties. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has highlighted in the Quran by saying, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you had to count the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it would be absolutely impossible for you to do so and count the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One is, it is impossible for us to count Allah's favors, but it's also difficult and almost impossible for a person to start counting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's favors and bounties. Because if by chance we were told that we should start counting Allah's favors and blessings upon us, then our logic would tell us that we should start with priority and importance. So how do we give preference and priority to one ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over another ni'mah and a bounty? Will a person give preference to his eyesight over his ability to speak? Or would a person give preference to his ability to speak over his ability to hear? So it's impossible to count Allah's favors. It's impossible to even start to count Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's favors. And as the poet says, that an-ni'matu idha fuqidat urifat. A ni'mah and a bounty, when it is lost and when it is taken away from a person, then a person really realizes what was the actual value of the ni'mah and the bounty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had blessed him with. But Allah's mercy upon us is such that Allah has made many of the ni'mats and the bounties that He has blessed us with replaceable to an extent. A simple example, a person might have a motor vehicle which might not be in the best of working orders and mechanical order, but it takes him from A to B. Now and then a person might even complain regarding that vehicle that is giving him problems. He's getting stuck here, he's getting stuck there, he needs somebody to tow him. And this is how he continues with this ni'mah. But Allah forbid if by chance that vehicle has to break down completely or has to be taken away from him or some mishap happens and now a person has no vehicle. So then he will realize what is the actual value of that ni'mah that many a times he probably did not like and he complained about, but now he realizes its actual value, what it was worth to him when it's no longer in his possession. But Allah's mercy upon insan is such that Allah has made many of the ni'mats and bounties that he has blessed us with replaceable. And sometimes the replacement of a ni'mah is far better than what an individual had in the first place. So keeping the example of the old vehicle in mind, that vehicle was taken away. Now we see a person buys a brand new motor vehicle in place of what was taken away from him or what he had lost. So he had an old vehicle, now Allah blessed him with a brand new one. So the replacement of a ni'mah is sometimes far better than what a person had initially. The same example we can cite with a cell phone, and like that we can use many other examples. But that's with regards to most ni'mats and blessings that Allah has given us. But there's one ni'mah and bounty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given every human being that has come into this world. There's one ni'mah that Allah has blessed each and every one of us with. But this ni'mah that Allah has blessed us with is absolutely irreplaceable. No amount of wealth in the world, no amount of power in the world, no force in the world, absolutely nothing can bring you a like of this ni'mah. Nothing can give you a replacement of it. This is such a ni'mah, once it is gone from your life and once it is taken away, it is gone for good and you can never ever get it back. And this ni'mah and this bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is none other than our parents that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted us with, our mothers and our fathers. And repeatedly in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights and reminds us as individuals and as insan, our duty that we owe to our parents, the manner in which we conduct ourselves with our parents, the manner in which we interact with our parents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in numerous places highlights the importance of parents. And the verse that we recited in the beginning, the famous verse of Surah Bani Israel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your Lord has ordained that you worship none but Him. So first and foremost, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is highlighting the importance of iman and tawheed and belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah has ordained that you worship none but Him. And immediately thereafter, the instruction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives in this verse is, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And we enjoy mankind to be good and kind to his parents. We advise man to be kind towards his parents and treat them with kindness and goodness. Now if we take this first part of the verse and then we analyze the hadith of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then we come to realize that one of the best and finest deeds that a believer can do after iman, once a person came to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam and said that Ayyul A'mali Afdal, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, tell us, what is the most virtuous action for a believer? What is the best deed that a person can do after he has brought iman? Now he has brought iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the most virtuous deed that a person can do? Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, As-salatu ala waqtiha. For a believer to perform salah at its appropriate time and in the correct manner and in a good manner, that's the best deed that a person can do after iman. Then the person asks, Thumma ay, O Nabi of Allah, what's next in line? Like somebody had to come to us and tell us that as a believer, what's the best deed that you can do as a Muslim? We also might say salah is the best thing that we can do. But if they ask us what's number two, what's next in line, these answers might vary amongst ourselves and amongst our own understanding and intellect. Some might say jihad, some might say fasting, some might say zakah, some might say hajj. We can give various other responses to this question. There's many virtuous deeds that we indulge in and we carry out. But what was the response of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam on this particular occasion? Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam answered the man by saying, Birrul Walidain. The second best deed that a believer can do after his salah is for him to be kind and courteous to his parents. Now that's how high Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has raised the level of being good to your parents as being one of the best and finest deeds that you can do as a Muslim. But let's look at the reverse of this. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on one occasion was mentioning major sins, big evil deeds, major sins, kabair. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, min al-kabair al-ishraku billah. From amongst the major sins and crimes that a human being can commit, the worst thing that a person can do is for him to ascribe partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, to us, that makes sense. If somebody had to ask us, okay, what's next in line? What's the second worst deed that a believer or a human being can commit and do? Now, here again, according to our intellect and our understanding, the answers might vary. Some might say gambling, some might say stealing, some might say consuming alcohol. We can give a whole list of evil deeds. But what was the response of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here when he was highlighting major sins? He said, min al kabair al ishraku billah. Amongst the major sins, number one is to ascribe partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, wa uququl walidain. For a person to disrespect and dishonor his parents. That is number two. Now imagine something really when we look at the world and what's happening in the world and how people conduct themselves and how people interact with their parents. Then something which can be rated as the second worst crime that a believer can commit. It has become so easily noticeable among society. It has become so easy for people to indulge in. And the sad part is that the seriousness of this wrong and this crime is slowly but surely slipping away from humanity. The seriousness of this crime is moving away from the minds and the hearts of people. If a man is pointed out to you and it is told to you that this individual is a murderer, then we all understand the seriousness of the person's crime and his wrong. We understand the seriousness of the crime, that this is a murderer. It's not a small thing. It's a big thing. If somebody has to point out an individual to us and say that this man is a perpetual alcoholic, here again we understand the seriousness of the crime and how wrong it is. We know what is the level of this wrong. But if somebody points out a man to you and says, this is aqun liwalidayhi, this is a man who disrespects his parents, we'll say, oh, okay, he's a man who disrespects his parents. May Allah give him hidayat. We don't take it as serious as we would take other sins and wrongs. For us, it's like one of those things. It happens in society. It's become so rampant in society and so common that people don't really worry about it. But yet, if it's something else, then we know the seriousness of it. Here, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that this is like one of the second worst deeds that a Muslim can commit, for him to disrespect and dishonor his parents. And one of the finest deeds that a believer can do is for him to be good to his parents, for him to be kind to his parents, and for him to be courteous to his parents. Now coming back to this verse, after Allah tells us, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا, Allah enjoins man to be kind to his parents. Allah then says, إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا. Allah says, if either you find one or both of your parents have attained old age. Now Allah highlights a very critical moment in the lives of our parents. Allah highlights a very, very important period in the lives of our parents. And if we look at the screens in front of us, it says that love your parents. We are so busy growing up, we forget that they getting old. Now here Allah is speaking about old age. So we so busy growing up, we forget that they are getting old. And we so busy getting strong, we forget that they are getting weak. And we are so busy coming up in life that we forget that now they on a downscale in life. They moving downhill. We so busy getting strong, they getting weak. We so busy getting intelligent and being full of ourselves. But little do we realize, as our strength increases, so does their strength decrease. As our intelligence rises, so does theirs to a certain extent decrease. And as we moving up in life, they are now moving down in life. And this is the critical moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights in the lives of our parents. And at this period in their life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us how we should conduct ourselves as children. Because no matter how old we are always the children of our parents. Irrespective of our age and our accomplishments in life, they are always our parents and they are always above us. So Allah says at this period in their life, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفْ. Allah says, don't even mention the word uff to them. And the commentators of the Quran have explained a lot on this expression of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that do not even mention the word uff. They explain it as being the lightest form of disrespect. The lightest form of disrespect is absolutely unacceptable in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now leave the lightest form of disrespect. Again, coming back and glancing at reality, it's not the lightest form of disrespect that's been meted out and shown to parents, but rather it's the worst forms of disrespect that parents unfortunately experience sometimes in the current situation and scenario that we find ourselves in. And the commentators of the Quran also interpret this uff as being the lightest hesitation in carrying out the command or the request of our parents. So if, for example, they tell you that carry out the small task for me, or fetch this from here, or bring that from there, and there's a moment of hesitance, and a person says, "Hey," and you pull back, and you're hesitating at their command, then even this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, is something that we should not do. Never. We should always be ready to serve our parents, and always be ready to be at their beck and call, and to serve them to the best of our abilities. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. We should never rebuke our parents, so we should never verbally abuse them in any way whatsoever. It's absolutely unacceptable, and this is a major sin according to our deen, and this is something which is very, very serious and something that we should definitely abstain from. But then Allah invites us and teaches us how we should speak and interact with our parents. And Allah says, وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. Speak to your parents in the most noble manner. قُلْ لَهُمَا. Say to them, قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. The most kind, the most noble of words, the best of expressions, those expressions filled with the most amount of love and respect, that's how you should speak to them. And regarding this part of the verse, there was a man who came to Sa'id bin Musayyib, who was a great tabi' and a great scholar of our deen, and he said to him, كُلُّ مَا ذَكَرَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فِي بِرِّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ عَرَفْتُهُ. He says, whatever Allah has mentioned in the Quran with regards to obedience of parents and being good to our parents, I've understood most of it. إِلَّا هَذَا الْقَوْلِ. Except this one statement of Allah, وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. I'm having difficulty in truly grasping the reality of these words. I don't know exactly what Allah is trying to say. Could you please assist me and enlighten me? What does Allah mean by these words? وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. So Sa'id bin Musayyib, who was a giant and a scholar of note, he answered this man with a profound statement. And he said, listen, my brother, for you to understand وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا, then you gotta understand قَوْلُ الْعَبْدِ الْمُذْنِبِ لِسَيِّدِ الْفَضِّ. The speech of a slave to his harsh and hard master. If you understand the manner in which a slave would conduct himself and speak to a harsh and hard master, then you will understand how you need to speak and address your parents. Now, we don't have slaves in the times that we live in, and we don't have masters above us who own us, but we have employers and we have employees. We have bosses and we have workers, and many people are employed by certain individuals. Now let's give a simple practical example. You are a worker, you're employed by a person who's not the most understanding of individuals, the most cooperative of individuals, and a person who's soft and kind-hearted and always ready to overlook your wrongs and your mishaps and your faults. We're speaking about a man who's harsh, a man who's hard, a person who rules by what they say, your iron fist, my way or the highway, there's the door. We're not desperate for somebody to work for us. That type of individual is above you. Now let's say by chance you as the worker have done something wrong. You've created some mishap in work, and there was a mistake that happened on your part, and now it's serious. It's put the company into turmoil. There's a big loss that the company has suffered. And now you've got to answer to this boss, who's not the most understanding of individuals, who's not the most compassionate of individuals. You've got to go to him and you've got to answer. Now, let's take a moment and pause and look within ourselves and ask ourselves, how would we interact with our boss in this situation? How would we speak to the man? What words would we choose? How careful we would be, knowing that this blunder that I've caused has actually put my entire career at risk. It has put my job at stake. Now, will a man go into a situation like that, boldly, uncaring, without thinking, blurt out and say, you know what, sorry boss, it's one of those things, I made a mistake. You can like it or lump it, there's nothing more I could have done. It's something you got to live with, it happens in life. No intelligent person would ever go in a situation and conduct himself in that manner. But rather a person would be fearful. He'll have a broader picture in front of him. It's not just about me meeting the boss now. It's about my career at stake. It's my job at stake. It's my future at stake. A person will tread so cautiously in a situation like that. In fact, in most instances, a person will be grappling to contain his emotion. How should he speak? He'll be nervous. He'll be worried. He'll have fear within him. Why? Because my job is at stake. So when a worker interacts and conducts himself with his boss, then he worries about his job being at stake. But as Muslims, on a daily basis, whenever we interact with our parents, and whenever we speak into our mothers, and whenever we speak into our fathers, it's not our job that's at stake, or it's not your career that's at stake. It's actually your Jannah that's at stake. It's your entire real future that's at stake. It's not a job that's on the line, it's Jannah that's on the line. Because a man came to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asked regarding parents. He said, what do I owe my parents? What are my parents to me? What do they really mean to me? Tell me something regarding my parents. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam summed it up in two words. He said, Huma jannatuk wa naruk. Your parents are either the means of you entering Jannah, they are either your paradise, or they could be the means of you entering hell. They are either your Jannah or they are your Jahannam. The choice is yours. So a worker interacting with his boss, his career is at stake. A believer speaking to his parents and interacting with his parents, Allah forbid, in a bad manner, it's not his job that's at stake, it's his Jannah that's at stake. It's a very, very serious thing. That's why Allah says, وَقُلَّهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. Speak to them in the best of manners. Speak to them in the most kind, courteous way, in a humble tone, with love and respect. And really, when we go back in our lives, and when we look from the time we were infants, from the very day that we entered this world, till today, we owe our entire existence to our parents. Allah says in another place in the Quran, أَنِشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ. You need to be grateful to me for all my ni'mats and bounties that I favored you with. But wali wali daik, you need to be grateful to your parents. How much they've done for us. How much of energies they've put into us. How much of time they've spent on us. How much of love they showered us with throughout our lives. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الظُّلِّ. Lower for them your wings of humility. That means shower them with kindness. Shower them with affection. وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. And Allah tells us that make dua to your parents by saying, oh Allah, shower them with mercy like they had done when I was young. Like how they showered me with mercy when I was young. Now we really need to just take a moment and look back at our lives and think of everything that we've achieved. Sometimes a person might look at his life and think that after so many years, I've built my own life, I've built an entire empire. Sometimes a person is climbing the corporate ladder in life and he always looks back and he attributes his success to his own effort. And many times you'll hear people saying that, you know, I put in a lot of work for this promotion. I worked very hard to get where I am today. It was because of my acumen, it was because of the effort that I put in, it's because of the time that I spent building myself up in life. That is why I am where I am today. But little does he realize that his position in life and his success in life has nothing to do with the effort that he had put in. It has nothing to do with his acumen, and it has nothing to do with his effort, but his success has everything to do with the fact that he had two people backing him all the way. He had two people behind him making dua for him all the time. He had two people spurring him all the way. They say that the only two individuals or groups of individuals in life that will always want to see you surpass them in life, while the whole world will be in competition with you and everybody will want to surpass you. There's only two groups of individuals that will want to see you surpass them in life. There's only two groups of individuals that when you do surpass them in life, then that is happiness and joy for them. It just brings joy to them that you surpass them in life. And it's something that they wish for and something that they always want to see. Those two groups of individuals are none other than our parents and our teachers. That's the only two groups of individuals that will want to see you succeed in life and surpass them in life. How often an old man will look proudly and say, see, this is the achievement of my son. This is what my son has risen to in life. This is what my son has achieved in his life. He looks at his son's effort and his son's achievement far greater than his own. And he is proud of his son and he makes dua for his son. So these are our parents and our gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. And when we look into the lives of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, we also see how much of consideration they gave for their parents. Let's just look at one companion, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, such a great Sahabi of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam, famous for being the one who had narrated the most amount of hadith from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. How would he start his day? We know how we start our days. The fortunate ones are those obviously who started with Fajr Salah and with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But thereafter, how do we begin with the rest of our day? Some people are stuck in traffic. Some people are rushing here, we're rushing there. Sometimes we're oversleeping and it's a hustle, it's a bustle. We're trying to get from A to B. And people are very, very busy in the morning. The roads are busy, everybody is busy, our minds are occupied, we're planning the rest of our day, we have our appointments, we have our schedules. Look at how Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu would begin his day. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu would wake up, obviously after performing his Fajr Salah and whatever else he needed to do, and when he would leave his house in the morning, the first thing he would do, he would go and knock at the door of his mother. Imagine, this is Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. He would knock at the door of his mother, and his mother would open the door. And then he would greet his mother by making salam to her. He would say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ya ummah. He would make salam to his mother. And then his mother would respond to his salam. And she would say, Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi ya bunayya. O my beloved son, may Allah's peace and blessings be upon you. And then he would tell his mother, O my beloved mother, rahimakillahu. O my mother, may Allah shower you with mercy. What a fine job you did of bringing me up in life. What a fine job you did of nurturing me as a youngster. What a wonderful job you did as a mother. Imagine Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu paying tribute to his mother for her efforts and sacrifices. Now, when was the last time we as kids and children thanked our parents for what they have done for us in life? They're not waiting for our thanks and they're not in need of our thanks. But it's our duty. When was the last time we said, Oh my dad, I thank you for everything you've done for me. When was the last time we said, Oh my beloved mother, I thank you for everything that you've done for me. Or how can I ever thank you for what you've done for me? It's impossible for us to repay our parents for what they have done for us in life. It's impossible for us to ever repay our parents or thank them enough for what they have done for us throughout our lives from the first day we came into this world. So Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu is paying tribute to his mother by saying, Oh my mother, may Allah shower you with mercy. What a fine job you did of bringing me up as a youngster. And what was the response of the mother of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu? And this is the important point that we want to touch on. His mother would listen to this and she would say, Rahimakallahu ya bunayya. Oh my beloved son, may Allah shower you with mercy. What a fine job you're doing of respecting me and honoring me and interacting with me at this age in my life. when I'm gone old, when I'm gone frail. What a good job you're doing of being a child, O Abu Huraira. May Allah shower you with mercy. Now this is the dua of a mother, a dua that will take us to heights that we can never ever imagine, a dua that is absolutely priceless, a door of dua that is open as long as only our parents are alive in this world. This is the dua of our parents, which is something that we should strive for. It's something that we should earn, and it's something that we should value more than gold. It is the most valuable thing to us. As I mentioned earlier, and we'll repeat it, sometimes we enjoy prosperity in life, we enjoy advancement in life, and we attribute it to our effort, when it has nothing to do with our effort, and it got everything to do with the du'as of our parents. Those du'as are extremely priceless to us. Those du'as are extremely valuable to us. And it is only when those doors of du'as are closed that a man will realize what was the actual value of those du'as. And it is only those du'as that will take us to strength, take us from strength to strength to life, and really make us prosper in our lives in this world. And this important period of old age that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about is important, because when our parents are young, there's not much that they need from us. In fact, that is the time where all their energies, their resources, their wealth, everything is being spent on us, and everything is for us. But once they become old, then the table seems to turn. Now we need to give back to them what they have given to us. We need to spend on them what they spend on us. One person asked one of the great scholars that, what is birrul walidain? What is being good to your parents? Hassan Basri was asked this question, that what is birrul walidain? He said, an tubadhila lahum ma mal, for you to spend on your parents all that you own, for you to spend all your resources on your parents, and for you to put the world at their feet, that is birrul walidain, because they put the world at your feet when you were young. How many, all our parents, if we really look at our parents, they are ready and prepared to sacrifice their necessities to fulfill the pleasures of their children. That is how parents work. Parents are ready to sacrifice their necessities to fulfill the pleasures of their children. How many, a child will be ready to sacrifice his pleasure for the necessity of his parents? How differently we think. How different is the love between parent and child? You know, the famous example is given that if Allah forbid a parent is sick and in hospital, Allah, may Allah keep all our parents well and with safety and salamat, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them all good health, and if they are ailing or sick in any way, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them shifa and keep them well and keep the shade over us. But if by chance a person's parents is in hospital and is in ICU, so you'll see the children perturbed, pacing up and down in the waiting room with worry and with concern that their parents are sick. And if you are to meet that child and you ask him, brother, how's your father doing? How's your mother doing? Whoever it might be, the man might be worried. He'll be sad. He'll say, no, Mana, I can't see my parents suffering. They're old. Make dua Allah make it easy for them. Make dua Allah make it easy for them. They mustn't suffer. So in a nutshell, it means may Allah take them away from this world. You know, they're going through a lot of difficulty. That would be sometimes the statement of a child. That is the love of a child. It's saying, make dua Allah, make it easy. But what is the love of a parent? Let's reverse the situations. Allah forbid, the child is sick. The child is in ICU. And there's a parent in the waiting room. There's a mother in the waiting room. There's a father in the waiting room. And you meet that parent and you say, how's your son doing? How's your child doing? How's your daughter doing? In almost all instances of this nature, the common sentiment of a parent would be that, Maulana or Sheikh, I can't see my child suffer like that. Rather Allah give me that sickness, but Allah must spare my child. I can't see my child suffering. Any, at the drop of a hat, in an instant, any parent will be ready to change scenarios. Rather the difficulty come upon me, I can't see my child going through that. That is the love of parents. That is these two individuals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. That is these two ni'mats that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted us, and we need to make the best of these gifts. We need to value these gifts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes man is negligent in this regard, And he doesn't really get a chance to value these gifts and these ni'mats. But ask any individual whose parents are no longer in this world, and he'll tell you that it's a gap in his life that can never ever be filled. He will tell you that it's a pain in his heart that never ever ceases. That's a wound within him that burns within him, that hurts him. And it's something that stays with him till the very day that he leaves this world. It's something that a person never forgets, the vacuum of his parents no longer being in his life. And fortunate are those who value their parents and know what is the reality of these two individuals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. Let's quickly go through a story of a man who had the opportunity of realizing at a later stage in his life, while his parents were still living, and at this critical moment of old age, what was the value of his parents. There was a man who was living abroad, and mashallah, he was doing very well financially, prospering, going from strength to strength, climbing up the corporate ladder, and he was doing very well for himself. And this man's habit was that once a year, his mother, who used to live in another country, he would fly her down. She would spend a few days with her son. Thereafter, he would send her back home. On this particular occasion, his mom comes to visit and he says, "Mom, you know, I've just got a new promotion. Alhamdulillah, I'm doing very well. I'm prospering like I can't believe. Mom, I've reached such a financial position now that I can safely tell you whatever your heart desires, I can buy for you. So, Mom, I'm going to take you shopping today. And whatever you see, don't look at the price." You know, on a lighter note, old people, you know, they'll always look at the price first. So here he says, "Mom, don't look at the price, but whatever you want today is yours. You want it, you will have it." So his mother says, "No, bye, don't worry about it, son. It's fine, I don't need anything." He says, "No, Mom, come, I have to spoil you. I've got a wonderful promotion. I've got a big bonus package. Come, let me take you shopping." So he takes his mom, puts her in his fancy vehicle, and he goes and he drives into town and he enters a wonderful plush boutique and he says, "Mom, choose whatever you want over here. Don't look at the price. Don't worry how much it is. Don't ask how much it is. Just look and see whatever you like, it's yours." So the mom looks and takes the time and she goes through each thing, obviously still looking at the prices, making sure it's not too expensive. She doesn't want her son to waste any money. So eventually she finds something, she looks at it, and then she turns the tag around, sees the price, and she moves away from it. And then at this moment, the son was looking at her. So he says, "Mom, I told you not to look at the price. Do you like what you've just seen?" So the mom says, "It looks nice, but no, it's too expensive, son. Please, no, it's way too expensive for me." So the son says, "Mom, I told you, today is the day that whatever you want, it's yours. Don't look at the price. If this is your choice, this is yours." So he takes it off the hanger, and he says, "Mom, this is yours." So the mom becomes happy. She says, "Son, no, man, don't spend so much of money. It's true. Let me find something else." The son says, "Mom, today is your day. This is for you. Take it." Once a year, his mother used to spend a few days with him. So then he says, "Mom, I want to see you wearing this. Go try it on now. Let me see how you look. I want to see how you look in it. You're going to wear it now, and we're going to go home." Mom says, "No, son, don't worry about that, man. I'll go home and we'll sort it out." He says, "No, Mom, try it on now. I want to see how it looks on you." And his mom goes into the fitting room. She tries on this dress. And a few moments later, she emerges. And the son is waiting patiently outside. And he sees his mother emerge in this garment that she has chosen, this garment that she likes. And he looks at his mother, and he notices that she's having a bit of difficulty and she's battling to fasten the buttons at the top of the dress. And then he looks closer and his gaze falls onto the hands of his mother. And now he looks at his mother's hands, frail, old, bent fingers, battling to fasten a button at the top of the dress. And then the man looks again. And now he begins to contemplate and he starts running back down memory lane. And he's looking at his mother battling to fasten this button. And he thinks to himself, "These are the hands that fed me. These are the hands that cleansed me. These are the hands that picked me up when I fell to the ground. These are the hands that had cleansed my entire body when I was filthy. These are the hands that I ran into when I was scared. These are the hands that picked me up when I fell. These were the hands that put clothes on my body. These were the hands that combed my hair. These were the hands that saw to my wounds and my hurts and my injuries. These were the hands that had cooked food for me for so many years. These were the hands that had taught me how to walk, that I held when I began to walk. These were the hands that picked me up every step of the way. At one stage in life, there was so much of strength in these hands that these hands could do miracles. These hands could do anything. And today, these same hands cannot tie one button. Today, these very same hands cannot fasten one button. And tears begin flowing from this man's eyes. And he goes forward and he holds the hands of his mother. And he kisses the hands of his mother. And he puts it on his forehead. And he looks at his mother and he says, "Oh my mother, how can I ever thank you for what these hands have done for me in my life? Oh my mother, how can I ever repay you for what these hands have done for me?" And he says, "Oh my mother, the normal routine is that you come and you spend a few days and you go back home. But now this routine is going to change. From today you will stay with me till the day you will leave this world or till the day I leave this world. But you're not going nowhere. I am not letting these hands out of my sight. I can't bear to stay without you." Now let's look at the hands of our parents. When was the last time we sat and looked at our parents properly with this eye? That what these two individuals have done for me. When you look at the hands of our mothers, what do we see? Is it just normal hands? Or is it hands that have earned a lot, toiled a lot, strived a lot? All the hands of our mothers have done immense work. When we look at the hunchback of our fathers, what do we see? How did that man's back become hunched? Every parent builds their life centered around their children. Every step of the way, it's only their children that are in consideration. When a man gets married and now he starts his family, so in his earnings, he considers his children. It's my children that are first. I need to worry about them. I need to worry about their education. I need to worry about them every step of the way. In the manner in which he builds his home, it's centered around his children. He accommodates his children. In every aspect of the lives of our parents, the only thing they do is keep consideration of their children. So every man builds his life centered around his children. How many a child will build his life centered around his parents? How often do we take them into consideration, like how they took us into consideration every step of the way? Life would have been so much more simpler if every man had to only worry about himself and nobody else. Would our parents have aged so drastically had they only worried about themselves? Or was party to their aging, them toiling after behind us and them spending their resources upon us? That is what made them old. That's what made the man's back hunched. That's what makes these hands of our mothers frail. So we need to look at our parents with these eyes and thank them and cherish the moments that we have with them. And they say that you only know what you owe your parents the day you become a parent yourself. Then only do we realize what is it that we owe to our parents. Then only we realize what it is to be a parent when we have our own children. Because sometimes when we're young, we are short-sighted. We don't have no foresight. We don't have real understanding. So for us, sometimes it's nagging. They are on our backs all the time. They're telling us to do this. They're telling us to do that. They're cramping our life. But the day we have our own offspring and we have our children, then we realize the foresight of a parent. Then we realize the vision of a parent. I need to protect my child. I need to guide my child. So to us it sounds like nagging when we are children. It sounds like they are on our backs all the time as children. But then when we get our own children, then we realize what we truly owe our parents, what we owe these individuals. And sometimes we learn from our children how we really need to conduct ourselves as parents, as children to our parents. There was one old man living with his son and his children. The old man living alone with his son, his wife and his grandchildren. And this man had become old and this man had become frail. So whenever he would sit at the dinner table, it was mess after mess and it was a problem after problem, the man would tip a glass over, or he would drop the spoon, or he would break the plate. Why? Because he was frail, he was old. Now every day it's a commotion on the supper table. The table is cloth is getting messed. The chinaware is breaking. The children are getting disturbed. Family supper is now becoming a headache. So the husband and wife take a decision that, listen, every day it's some issue or the other. All my fine cornerware and chinaware is being broken. So the wife tells her husband, look, you know, we need to do something about this. It's becoming a bit difficult having supper every day with dad. He's gone old. He's gone frail. Every day it's some problem or the other. We need to have a peaceful meal and a nice supper with no disturbances, no mishaps, no cleaning up, no problems. So they take a decision. They say, no, what we'll do is we'll move him to one corner of the dining room. Just put one small table there with the chair. Let's give him a plastic spoon and a bowl so he can sit over there. There'll be nothing to break. If by chance he has to soil something and drop or spill something, it will be spilling on himself. It will be messing in one corner. It will have nothing to do with us. We can have a peaceful, wonderful supper. So that night, at the time of supper, the old man enters the dining room and he's ushered to his own special, so-called special table in the corner. And this man quietly goes, takes his seat, eats his meal, and exits the room. You see, many a times we take the silence of our parents for granted. We think that they don't mind. We think that because they're not saying anything, it's fine. Everything seems to be fine. But they don't have to speak for them to voice their hurt. They don't have to speak for them to really voice their feelings. Just by looking at our parents, we know what they're feeling. And wallah, even if they don't speak, Allah knows what's going through the hearts of each and every one of our parents. And sometimes the speech of their hearts is far more deep-rooting and affecting than the speech of their tongues. Because really what their hearts feel is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at. And the dua from their heart is the one that holds the most amount of weight in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah forbid if it's something else that in the hearts of their parents, that can be sometimes the thing that affects us the most and the thing that becomes the biggest hurdle in our life. And it's such a serious thing with regards to disobedience of parents that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Kullu dhunub," every single sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive as He pleases. If Allah wishes, Allah can forgive a person, and if Allah wills, Allah can take a person to task. So every sin that a human being commits, Allah has the free rein to forgive or to take retribution. إِلَّا عُقُوقُ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, except for the sin of disobedience of parents. There's no choice. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the ill effects of disobedience of parents will reach a person in this world before he reaches Allah. So you'll see the ill effects of it in this world, and Allah forbid if a person does not make tawbah, there's far more consequences for him to face when he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the duas, our parents don't really speak sometimes when things go wrong. They are silent, but we need to be very, very careful and tread cautiously at these moments. So this man continues every day sitting in his corner, eating his food, soiling, messing himself, and the rest of the family is very, very happy. Then one day, this young man who moved his father to the corner, he had a young son, a son who was very fond of his grandfather. And one day he sees his young son playing with his blocks and busy with all his toys. He's got a toy hammer, he's got his toy saw, and he is busy enjoying himself. So the young father walks past and he says, "Son, what you busy doing?" The son says, "Dad, I'm very busy. I'm making something." So the dad is excited. This is his young son speaking and interacting with him. He says, "Son, what you making? That looks very interesting." He says, "Dad, I can't tell you. It's a surprise." So the father gets excited. He says, "Surprise? Who are you going to surprise for?" He says, "Dad, it's a surprise for you and mom." Now the father becomes ecstatic. This is his young boy, his pride and joy, his investment for the future, a part of him, a child that he waited for and he made dua for and he's happy to see growing up every step of the way. He becomes happy. He says, "Son, what's that? Surprise, tell me now, I want to know." So the son says, No, Dad, I can't tell you. Let me finish first, let me finish it, and then I'll give it to you and mom. It's a special surprise for you all." So the father says, "No, son, come, tell me now, I can't wait, please tell me. I'll do anything for you. Tell me what's the surprise. I want to see what you're making for me, my beloved son. So the son turns around and he says, Dad, I'm making a table for you and Mum when you all get old. And this made the father freeze. And he looks at his son. And then he realizes the reality of the words of his son. And he doesn't say anything. He just holds his emotion and he walks away. So that night, at the time of supper, here comes the old fragile man. He enters the dining room and he sees that there's no more table in the corner. And now this old man fears the worst. And now he feels within himself that from the main table he's moved to the corner. Now there's no table in the corner. It seems as if he no longer has a place in this home. And he turns around and he begins to exit the dining room without saying anything. When his son wakes up from his chair, goes to his father. And then he holds the hand of his father. And he hugs his father. And he kisses his father. And he gently brings his father forward towards the main table once again. Moves his chair where he was seated. And he tells his father, my beloved father, this is your place in this home, and this is your position in this family, and this is the seat that you will sit in from today till the day you leave this world. This will always be your place. And then he takes his seat next to his father, because the words of his young boy had really affected him. Then he realized the seriousness of the situation, that the manner in which we interact with our parents is actually the manner in which our children will interact with us. So if we do the best that we can to interact with our parents who really love us the most, who have really done the most for us, we're thankful to the world. We appreciate simple favors that people do for us. We know that the value of appreciation. We know the value of giving back. Do we really know the value of those who have given us the most? Do we really know the value of those who love us the most? Who else will love us like our parents? Who else will appreciate our efforts and our good other than our parents? People will sometimes be good to us and thereafter it will change. People will sometimes be loyal to us and sometimes they will be disloyal to us. There's no better loyalty than the loyalty of parents. What they haven't done for us, how much they've showered us with in our life, how much of love they give us. And it's unbiased love, it's free love, it's something that you cannot understand. It's absolutely you can't explain the love of parents, to what levels it reaches, to what depths it goes. The love of our parent, the whole world will hate us, but our parents will still love us. The whole world will turn against us, but our parents will still be there and stand by our side. If everybody moves away from us, sometimes you see people in difficult conditions. People are messed up. They're involved in vice, they're involved in drugs. The whole society will kick them out. But the mother will still cry and say, that's my son. That's my flesh and blood. That's a part of me. A father will still say, that's my son. Irrespective of how low we fall in life, they'll be the ones to pick us up. Irrespective of how high we go up in life, they will be the ones spurring us all the way and dare to celebrate our achievements and our success. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the tawfiq and the ability to really realize what is the value of these two individuals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. If both our parents are still living in this world, then really first we need to thank Allah. Oh Allah, I thank you for the opportunity that you've given me by sparing both my parents. And we need to make an earnest effort to do the best that we can. We are not perfect. Sometimes we might slip. Sometimes we might err along the way. But let's always be on guard. Let us realize the seriousness of the situation. Let us realize the value of the opportunity that Allah has given us. We can earn our Jannah just by serving our parents. We can earn our Jannah just by being good to our parents. And we can earn the highest of stages in Jannah. And at the same time, we can earn the best of this world. And if by chance our parents are no longer in this world, then remember that the duty of a child is not for as long as your parents live in this world, but rather the duty of a child is for as long as you live in this world. So even if our parents are no longer in this world and it's been a year or 2 years or 10 years or 20 years or even 50 years ago that your parents have left this world, remember as a child you still have certain duties and obligations. You still have a lot of things that you need to do. A person came to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and asked such a wonderful, important question. He said, O Nabi of Allah, is there anything left for me to do as a child? Are there any rights that my parents have over me once they have left this world? Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Naam, yes, there's a whole list of things that you as a child still need to carry out. He said, As-salatu alayhima wal-istighfaru lahuma. You need to make dua for your parents, dua in maghfirah, make dua that Allah forgive them, seek istighfar on their behalf. And you need to make as much dua as possible for them. And the ideal dua is what Allah has taught us in the Quran. وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. Oh Allah, shower them toward mercy as they had done when I was young. And then Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that you need to fulfill whatever wishes and aspirations that your parents had in their lifetime, whatever promises they had made, whatever wishes they had, you need to fulfill that as a child. You need to maintain relationships with their distant family members, and those relationships which only existed via them, you need to maintain those relationships with people who they might have known in their lifetime, and their distant family members, you need to keep in touch with those people. That is considered as you've been good to your parents. And the last one, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَإِكْرَامُ صَدِيقِهِمَا. You need to honor the friends of your parents. And when we look at this, then we understand that anybody even remotely connected to your parents after they've left this world, by you being good to those people, you are actually being good and kind and courteous to your parents. But let's look at this last point of honoring the friends of our parents. You see, on one occasion, Abdullah bin Umar, Abdullah the son of Umar radiallahu anhu, the second Khalifa of Islam. Once he was traveling to a certain place and he had a group of students with him and individuals around him. And as he was traveling along the road, he noticed in the distance an old man sitting at the roadside. So as he got closer, he looked at this man and he seemed to have recognized him. So he turned his conveyance and he began moving towards this old individual seated on the side of the road. And he goes and he jumps off his mode of transport, his animal. He runs to this old man. He picks him up. He hugs him. He kisses him. He takes his amama or his hat that he was wearing and he places it on the head of this old man. And then he holds this man's hand. He brings him forward towards his own mode of transport, his animal that he was riding. He helps this old man onto this animal and he says, Oh my beloved uncle, take this animal and for you and continue, go wherever you are headed towards. And the people around Umar Abdullah radiallahu anh, they become extremely surprised. Never before had Abdullah done such a strange act. A stranger old man looked like a beggar seated on the side of the road, and Abdullah is showing this man so much of honor, so much of respect. He's given this man his whole mode of transport. This is something very strange. So they say that, Oh Abdullah, this was a simple man. He would have been happy with a few coppers or a few dinars or dirhams or something small. What was the need for you to go to such a great extent in honoring him and being so generous to him? Now let's put it in a practical example. Let's say a man is driving the latest Mercedes-Benz, top of the range. Grand saloon, a person is driving a luxury saloon, you're driving an S-Class, or you're driving a BMW, top of the range, a million rand vehicle. Actually, million rand is not even top of the range now, it goes much more than that. 2 million, 3 million rand, Rolls Royce. So then he's driving and he's moving in a certain direction, and suddenly he sees an old, so to say, beggar at the side of the road. And let's say, me or you are at the roadside, and we're watching this whole scenario, here comes a man with a flashy car. And then suddenly he stops, and he jumps off his car and he goes to what we would term as a beggar on the street and he picks him up, and this man is clad in an expensive Hugo Boss jacket, 5 or 10,000 rand, takes off his jacket, he puts it on that beggar, and then he takes the man's hand, puts him in his S-Class Grand Saloon, top of the range luxury vehicle, and he tells him, Uncle, this car is yours. Now we look at this man and we'd say there's something seriously wrong with him. Either he's mental or definitely he has one or two nuts loose. How can you give a beggar an S-Class? How can you give a man a whole car? So this was, the people around Abdullah were shocked. How could you go to such an extent to honor such a simple man? So Abdullah turns around and he looks at his people and he says, كان ودا لعمر. You know who this man was? This man was the friend of my father Umar radiallahu anhu. And I heard my beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, إِنَّ أَبَرَّ الْبِرِّ. One of the finest acts of virtue that a son or a child can do for his parents once they've left this world is for him to honor the friends of his parents. Actually, what I did was inadequate. It wasn't enough. I should have did more if I was able. I need to do more. But this man was the friend of my father, Umar. That's why I did what I had done. Now let's ask ourselves the question. If this was the love and respect for the friend of the father of Abdullah radiallahu anhu, then what was the love, respect and honor that Abdullah really had for his father, Umar radiallahu anhu? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all tawfiq to really cherish our parents, to make dua for them, to make the best of the time we have for them, and we'll definitely see the benefits of this world, the benefits of it in this world, and definitely there'll be more so left for us when we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all tawfiq. And as we open up the discussion by saying that Allah has blessed us with many ni'mats, and Allah has made most of the ni'mats that He has blessed us with replaceable. And at times the replacement of a ni'mah is far better than what you had in the first place. But there's one ni'mah that's absolutely irreplaceable. No matter what, we can never get the like of it. And that irreplaceable ni'mah is none other than our mothers and our fathers. And a person put it very nicely by saying, treat them with the best of love and care. You will only know their value when you see their empty chair. Treat them with the best of love and care. You will only know their value when you see their empty chair. And we don't want to reach that stage when we see the empty chair that we realize their value. May Allah grant us all the tawfiq and the ability to realize their value long before that chair becomes empty. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all tawfiq. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.